بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا مزيدا إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد, in the last two حلقات I gave a brief introduction about تمكين, and then I began to mention the story of the stranger of آل ياسين. In the last حلقة I began to mention the portion of the story where the stranger went running in support of the messengers. We left off when the stranger was addressing and admonishing the people of the town who disbelieved in the messengers. It was all, last halaqah was all about one ayah. وَجَاءَ مِنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ رَجُلُ يَسْعَى قَالَ يَا قُومِ اتَّبِعُوا الْمُرْسَلِينَ. From the remotest, furthest part of the town, a man came rushing. He said, "Oh, my people, follow the messengers." The following verse is, اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا وهم مهتدون. Follow those who ask for no reward. They're not asking for fees or wages or payment. On top of that, وهم مهتدون, they're rightly guided. Notice how the previous verse, the ending of the previous verse that we took yesterday, it says اتبعوا المرسلين. اتبعوا المرسلين. Follow the messengers. This verse today says, starts off with اتبعوا, which means follow. اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا. Follow those who don't ask for reward. In Arabic, had it been with one follow, meaning the verse would have been follow the messengers who don't ask for reward, rather than how it is, follow the messengers, follow those who don't ask for reward. Had it been one sentence with one follow, would have been a complete accurate Arabic statement. But repeat and follow is to affirm and add emphasis and assurance to following the messengers and to the important reasons that he gave for following them. The first reason he gave to convince them to follow the messengers is that they're sent by Allah. And that's why we follow the messengers. اتبعوا المرسلين. They are sent by Allah. The second reason he gave, and it's secondary, that's why he mentioned it second, it's an additional reason used to convince and show their completeness as messengers and their truthfulness, that they don't ask for reward and that they are guided, among other characteristics. He said they're not asking for fees or wages. One who embraces da'wah must be in it to give for the sake of Allah and not to gain but the pleasure of Allah. No dunya gain. In fact, in the da'wah field, in its various methods, you need to give all the dunya resources that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed you with, such as your time, your honor, your wealth, your effort, your entire life. It's a noble mission you as a stranger are doing. It's the same mission of the messengers and the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except you don't get revelation. So don't think that noble mission and task with materialistic dunya gains and seek only the multifolds of reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This man here used some of the best, most compassionate ways of persuasion. He told them that they're guided and that they don't want no gain in return. There's nothing in it for themselves. And how many du'a today can say that? How many can say that we're not banking off the da'wah? We're not living off our da'wah efforts. Reward isn't only a paycheck as some may perceive. It could be fame, followers, prestige, positions, notoriety. You always hear some people say, but how can they live or how can we live? The same way the messengers and the pious ulama did. Look at the verses in the Quran. فَإِن تَوَلَّيْتُمْ فَمَا سَأَلْتُكُمْ مِنْ أَجْرٍ إِنْ أَجْرِيَ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ وَأُمِرْتُ أَنْ أَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. In Surah Yunus. وَيَا قَوْمِ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مَالًا إِنْ أَجْرِيَ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ وَمَا أَنَا بِطَارِدِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ وَلَكِنِّي أَرَاكُمْ قَوْمًا تَجْهَلُونَ. In Surah Hud, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala quoted him as saying, قُلْ مَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَجْرٍ وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُتَكَلِّفِينَ. In Surah Sad. And he said it again in Surah Al-Furqan, قُلْ مَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَجْرٍ إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ أَنْ يَتَّخِذَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِ سَبِيلًا. Various messengers throughout the Quran, worded differently, in different situations and circumstances, all reiterating the same concept. Nuh, alayhi salam, who was among them, he served 950 years in da'wah. repeating to his people over and over that he doesn't take payment. While the buffoons of da'wah today can go give a lecture or write a book or an article or lead salah at a masjid without getting prepaid with incentives and accommodations. Da'wah to change and uplift this ummah is not a corporate industrial 8-to-5 job. There's an imanic spiritual aspect to the task of da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even though it's a disputed matter and we don't have time to go over the various opinions and proofs and counterproofs on whether one can be compensated for da'wah, what needs to be kept in mind is that righteous du'a should hold themselves to the highest standard, especially in matters like this, because after all, they're the heirs of the messengers who said, "La as'alukum alayhi ajra." You can't inherit one aspect and then reject another. Which messenger do you know of that took the equivalent of a penny or less or more than that for his da'wah efforts? The hearts need to be fully independent. A true da'iyah furthers himself as much as possible from gaining financial matters in his da'wah efforts. The niyyah needs constant rejuvenation, and one struggles day and night to keep his niyyah in his da'wah pure. That's without taking gains. So imagine how it is when dunya, wealth, and gains are involved. It only gets worse knowing most of those so-called du'a or shuyukh incline to their patrons in their speeches and in their fatwas, whether it may be governments or individuals or institutions, and sometimes the reward they get blindens them to the point that they don't even perceive that they're inclined to them. In Sunan Abu Dawood and Ibn Majah, Ubadah ibn Samit radiyallahu an said, "Allamtu nasan min ahl as-suffah al-Qur'an wal-kitaba. Fahda ilayya rajulun minhum qawsa." I taught some people from the Suffah, the poor people in Medina, the poor people of the Suffah. I taught them some Quran and how to write. One of them gave me a bow. فَقُلْتُ لَيْسَتْ بِمَالْ وَأَرْمِ عَنْهَا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. He said, "It's not money, it's just a bow." You can sort of see that the way he worded it, that he wouldn't have took if it was money. But he said it's not, his wording was, it's not money, and I can use this bow to shoot for the sake of Allah with it. فَسَأَلْتُ, but he had doubt, so he went to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَسَأَلْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم عنها. So I asked the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم about it. The Messenger said, "If it would please you to have a necklace of fire placed around your neck, then accept it. إن صرك أن تطوق بها طوقا من نار فاقبلها." And I'll say again, disputed matter, okay. It's disputed. But if you know that a mujahid who puts his most precious at stake for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then takes from that which is not disputed, the ghanima for a mujahid is not disputed, unlike the rewards of da'wah. It's a right of a mujahid by the clear ayat and ahadith. So if a mujahid who puts his life at stake chooses to take from the undisputed right of his, of ghanima, he ends up losing some of his reward in the akhirah. You know how much he loses? Look at this hadith in Sahih Muslim. عن عبد الله بن عمر أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من ما من غازية تغزو في سبيل الله فيصيبون الغنيمة إلا تعجلوا ثلثي أجرهم من الآخرة ويبقى لهم الثلث وإن لم يصيبوا غنيمة تم لهم أجرهم. A troop of soldiers who fight in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and take from their share of the ghanima, the booty, will receive in advance 2/3 of their reward, and only 1/3 will remain to their credit in the akhirah. If they don't receive any of the booty, any of the ghanima, they'll get their full reward. 2/3 of the reward of a mujahid who fights for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and has a right to acquire any spoils of war are lost because he took a share of the booty of the ghanima, which is not disputed, unlike the rewards and incentives of da'wah. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the ghanima, enjoy it. فَكُلُوا مِمَّا غَنِمْتُمْ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا. Enjoy what you have gotten of the booty of the war. Lawful and good for you. In Sirah Alam al-Nubala, al-Dhahabi rahimahullah said, During the time of Harun al-Rashid, there was 20,000 soldiers in his army who refused to record their names in the office of the army registry. They won't put their names on list because they didn't want wages and they didn't want no one to know them but Allah. 20,000. Imagine those who take for da'wah efforts or worse than that, demand and expect it, or those who sit and negotiate and increase or demand more benefits and incentives or request payments to be upfront, or those who become wealthy off their da'wah, so-called da'wah, or those who refuse to return to a platform where they gave da'wah because they didn't pay them the previous time. The motto of the heirs of the messengers is, my reward is only with Allah, and ajriya illa ala Allah. That portion of the verse in that exact wording with a different ending is mentioned 9 times in the Quran. There's many other differently worded verses with the same meaning on this topic. However, my reward is only with either Fatarani or Rabbil Alameen or Allah is mentioned 9 times in the Quran. In Ajriya illa ala Allah is 3 times. In Ajriya illa ala alladhi fatarani is 1 time. In Ajriya illa ala Rabbil Alameen, it's 5 times. And let me mention the surahs they're in that probably actually help some huffaz. In Ajriya illa ala Rabbil Alameen is mentioned 5 times in the Quran. If it's in Surah Al-Shu'ara, you know the ending is Rabbil Alameen. My reward is with the Lord of the worlds, Rabbil Alameen. So 5, and all 5 of them are in Surah Al-Shu'ara with the end of Rabbil Alameen. There's one Fatarani in Ajriya illa ala alladhi fatarani, which is in Surah Hud. My reward is with the one who created or sustained me or provides for me. Fatarani, the term Fatarani in Ajriya illa ala alladhi fatarani 1 time. There's 3 times in Ajriya illa ala Allah, and those 3 times my reward is only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those 3 times are in Surah Yunus, in Surah Hud, and in Surah Saba. In Surah Yunus and Hud, it's in the story of Nuh alayhi salam who said that. In Surah Saba, it's the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who mentioned it. In Ajriya illa ala Allah. That of course will help Huffaz eliminate some confusion in these verses. But more importantly, it's for our topic to show the importance of this matter by the number of times it's reiterated throughout the Quran. Keep in mind there's other ayat worded differently that state the same concept like the one we have here. اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا. They don't have a form to fill out or payment methods to access their classes and websites and lectures. They're not imploring people for donations and begging for equipment. The more you learn of the path of the messengers and the righteous salaf and ulama, the path of the true ghuraba, the more you see how distant and astray the buffoons of da'wah are. وَمَا لِيَ لَا أَعْبُدُ الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي. The next verse. وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. وَمَا لِيَ لَا أَعْبُدُ الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي. Why should I not worship the one who has created and originated me, and to whom I will return? Why should I not worship the one who created me? That's like a rhetorical question. It's to make a point. Why should I not believe? There's absolutely no reason for me not to believe. It's more like a self-astonishment question. I would be astonished at my own self if I didn't believe. You notice he went from directing his speech to them to directing his speech to his own self. Because he's a believer. وَمَا لِيَ لَا أَعْبُدُ الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي. Why shouldn't I worship me? Because he's a believer, not them. And he's confident about who created him and about his creed and belief. وَمَا لِيَ. There's nothing. وَمَا لِيَ لَا أَعْبُدُ. There's nothing that prevents me from believing. I'm not scared physically from you. And you can't give me any convincing arguments against what I believe. وَمَا لِيَ لَا أَعْبُدُ الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي. فَطَرَنِي. I owe it to Allah. I believe and worship him because he created me. He originated me. He sustained me. And this established fact requires that I believe in him. That's why you should believe in him as well. وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. Then he redirected his speech back at the people. He told them, and you will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's saying, believe in Allah for being the one who fatarani, meaning he created and sustained us and blessed us so much. And that's why you should believe in him. But if that's not enough for you to appreciate that, then accept the fact that he's irresistible and supreme and you're going to return to him. He's confirming to them what's going to happen in the life after. وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ is mentioned 9 times in the Quran. The only surah that it's mentioned twice in is in Surah Yasin. In this verse and in the very last verse of this surah. وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ إِلَيْهِ is a prepositional phrase. It's a jar wa majroor. تُرْجَعُونَ is a fi'al mudari'. It represents a present or future tense verb. In Arabic, when the prepositional phrase comes before the verb, it's usually to limit the meaning. In this verse, it's to limit and narrow the return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Meaning, the word-to-word translation of this verse says, to Allah you will return. But because the prepositional phrase, ilayhi, came before the verb, turja'un, the added meaning becomes, to Allah alone you will return. Let me give you another example from another verse. قُلْ هُوَ الرَّحْمَنُ آمَنَّا بِهِ وَعَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا. Say he is Ar-Rahman, Allah. We believe in him. And in him we put our trust. We believe in him and in him we put our trust. We believe in him and in him we put our trust. آمَنَّا is the verb. بِهِ is the prepositional phrase, the جَار وَمَجْرُور. I said when the prepositional phrase comes before the verb, it's to limit the meaning. But here, amanna, we believe in Ar-Rahman, came before the prepositional phrase, bihi. Why is believe in Ar-Rahman not limited? That's because you need to believe in Ar-Rahman. But also to believe in Ar-Rahman, he told you that you need to believe in the messengers and in the books and in the angels and in the pillars of faith and so on. But amazingly, after that prepositional phrase, bihi, comes another different verb, وَعَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا. In him we put our trust. تَوَكَّلْنَا came after the prepositional phrase, bihi, which ends up meaning, we only put our reliance and trust in Allah alone. Believe in Allah, amanna, came before the prepositional phrase, bihi, because we believe in Allah, but in order to fully believe in Allah, you must also believe in what he told you to believe in, like the other pillars of faith. While tawakkul is mentioned after the prepositional phrase to show our trust is only Allah, on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. There's no type of tawakkul on other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes the prepositional phrase comes before the verb in the Quran for other reasons, such as to highlight, praise, or compliment someone or something. Back to our topic, وَمَا لِيَ لَعْبُدُ الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. The stranger used fear and hope in his da'wah statements. Why shouldn't I worship the one who created me? That represents hope. تَرْغِيب. تَرْغِيب. Created, gave us. تَرْغِيب. You should worship him. You will return to him. That's tarheeb, fear. Meaning if you don't believe, you're returning to a severe punishment. A da'iyah balances his hope and fear throughout his da'wah. He redirected his speech at them when he said, and you will return to Allah, even though he will return to Allah just like they will. Because he directed it at them because it's admonishment to them. His return to Allah as a worshiping believer is a return to the pleasure of Allah, while their return to Allah, if they remain disbelieving sinners, is to punishment and humiliation. أَتَّخِذُ مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً إِن يُرِدْنَ الرَّحْمَنُ بِضُرٍّ لَا تُغْنِ عَنِّي شَفَاعَتُهُمْ شَيْئًا وَلَا يُنْقِذُونَ. How could I take anything below him as an alihah, as a god? وَمَا لِيَ لَا أَعْبُدُ, the previous verse is to affirm tawheed. It's ithbat, affirm tawheed. أَتَّخِذُ مِن دُونِهِ, this verse now, is nafi, negation. It's to negate shirk and worshiping other than Allah. He's teaching them the complete fulfillment of tawheed, النَّفِي وَالْإِثْبَاتِ, to affirm and negate. مِن دُونِهِ, من دوني shall I take beneath Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala beneath him a god. من دوني is not accurately translated as besides, but more precisely it means below, beneath, less. How can I take anything below, beneath, and less than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a god? إن يردن الرحمن بضر لا تغني عني شفاعتهم شيئا. الرحمن, if he intends to harm me, their intercession will be of no benefit and use for me whatsoever. ولا ينقذون, and they can't even save me. You want me to worship and obey something that can't even save me? A stranger like this stranger, if he doesn't continuously remind himself of the verses like this, he's destined to relapse. Verses like this irrigate the heart with tranquility and tawakkul on Allah and submission to whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for you. The false aliha that they took, just like individuals and governments and intelligence and everything and everybody else, their intercession can't spare me and you if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to harm me and you. And likewise, if Allah wishes to save us, nobody can harm us. If Allah wishes to save us from harm, He'll distance me and you from it so far that we may not even know of it or see it. He will not harm find its path to us. Or He may let us and harm me, but then we depart from harm untouched. Al-Thawri rahimahullah mentioned something that will further clear the meaning of this verse. He said in Al-Fawa'id, إِذَا اتَّقَيْتَ اللَّهِ كَفَاكَ النَّاسِ. إذا اتقيت الله كفاك الناس وإن اتقيت الناس لن يغنوا عنك من الله شيئا. Allah will be all you need. He will suffice you from people if you fear and obey Him. If you fear and obey people, they will be of no avail or benefit to you against Allah if He wants to harm you. إني إذا لفي ضلال مبين. In that case, if I associate a partner to Allah, I'll be completely astray and lost. إني آمنت بربكم فاسمعون. I believe in your Lord, so listen to me. Listen to me is the catch line of the stranger muwahhid. إني آمنت بربكم فاسمعون. He didn't want him just to listen. He meant listen and accept the call of tawheed. The beauty of this life and its sweetness is in tawheed wallah. And in bringing victory to tawheed and the establishment of tawheed on this earth and calling others to it. But that needs men like this man. Men who raise their voices saying fasma'un, so others can hear. And then be firm when everyone revolts against you. قيل ادخل الجنة قال يا ليت قومي يعلمون. They killed him, so he's greeted into Jannah. The Quran doesn't specifically mention that they killed him because it's obvious in the context of the ayat. It was said to him, enter Jannah. He said, if only my people knew. He's on his way to Jannah, yet his mind is set on spreading tawheed and on his people. He said, if only my people knew. We'll continue from here tomorrow, inshallah. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.